Relax. You may wish to be on the edge of your seats as you receive dynamic inspiration from our Reverend John Scott. Please welcome him.
Thank you, Jen. Don't relax. Sit on the edge of your seats and prepare to embrace the gift of life, which I have titled this morning's encouragement. Love to add my own words of welcome to my heart and to our beautiful Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living in warm and balmy Kingston, Jamaica, and to also welcome all those who join us in consciousness by viewing us on the World Wide Web. Our Centers of Spiritual Living mission, awakening humanity to its spiritual magnificence, underscores for me the necessity for humankind to wake up, to really wake up to the truth of our being. And I've had a lot of time to be contemplating this gift of life, this precious gift that we have been given in recent weeks. And it is a gift that never, ever expires. Fenwick Holmes, who was the brother of religious science founder Dr. Ernest Holmes, tells the story of a man who was cast ashore on an island. The storm had dashed him unhurt across the breakers into a lagoon. Behind him was a high cliff which he was unable to climb. Quote, "At first I made desperate efforts to escape," he said, "but finally reconciled myself to a slow death by thirst and starvation. I believe that I was the only person on the island and that rescue was not only unlikely, but impossible. I did not know that beyond the cliff there was a snug harbor where natives were engaged in pearl fishing. I believed myself to be alone and was possessed by an indescribable terror as death came toward me slowly. I thought of my mother and wished I had been kinder to her before her death. I regretted that I had not lived a more generous life. And then suddenly I felt impelled to pray, although I had not done so for many years. I recalled that I had had a lifelong quarrel with my brother, and the cause of it now seemed so trivial and unworthy. I mentally asked for his forgiveness. It was at this point that I became unaccountably calm. My mind became very sharp and I opened my eyes. It was then that I saw a tiny cleft in the cliff above me, which ran diagonally across the rock and ended on a shelf within reach of an agile man. I had missed it before in my crazed effort to escape because I had been too close to the wall. It gave me new hope, and I felt sure I could work my way upward if I could regain enough strength," unquote. The shipwrecked man said that even in that tense moment, he felt that in some way this means of escape had been shown him because he had made a new man of himself through his prayers. Quote, "I had been hypnotized by the feeling of guilt and fear. I now seemed to be awake and had a sense of lightness. The relief was so great that I must say I laughed out loud. Had anybody seen or heard me at that moment, they would have thought the lightness came out of my head instead of my heart," unquote. You know, friends, I dare say, thank God none of us have been shipwrecked, but many of us have felt up against the wall, haven't we? Unable to see our way over or around seemingly insurmountable cliffs of life's challenges and life's problems. And too often we give in to the fear and despair, and it is only when we feel that we are facing certain death that we think to pick up the phone and call the church and ask for a practitioner or a minister to pray. And Reverend Elmer, our beloved founding minister, always told the joke about the person who was really ill, and the person said, her family said, "Oh Lord, we better pray." And the person said, "Lord Jesus, it come to that." How easily we forget that we have inner resources which can be drawn upon by faith hope and prayer. And so I want to remind you this morning that when you are up against the wall and you cannot see the cleft in the rock because you're too close to the problem, there is a cadre of trained practitioners who can know the truth for you, that there is always a way through the challenge, around the challenge, and that there is no obstacle that's too big for the God that is within each and every one of us. Physiologists know that our adrenal glands play an important part in courageous effort. They stimulate all the organs of action, and adrenaline rushes through the blood and washes the dross of effort from the muscles, removing the friction of weariness which impedes our agility. It is at these times that new strength returns, and we all know stories of the mother who could pull a truck, 10-ton truck, off her child's leg in that moment when the adrenaline kicks in and she knows she has to do something to save the child's life. It is at these times that we find that strength, and we feel alive and able to do anything. But we don't have to wait for an adrenaline rush. Whenever you become still and tap that inner presence and power that is waiting within you to be tapped, you will do the same thing without having to use up all that adrenaline. So when you think you can, finish it for me. You can. All things are possible to him who believeth. And the Bible tells us, he giveth strength to the weary, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. This is from Isaiah 40, 31. And I want to remind you, since we just sang Lord of the Universe, that we are not talking about some little man sitting upon a golden throne in the clouds when we say Lord. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. That's not some personality that's whimsical and that dispenses favors to people if you just pray right. Wherever you see the word Lord in the Bible, you can substitute the word law. The law is your shepherd. They that wait upon the law of cause and effect, they that wait upon the law shall indeed renew their strength. Because when you know the law and know how to use it, nothing is impossible to you. God's gift of life then can never be exhausted and it cannot run out. That's a law. It is in our brains and it is in our bodies. It is in the air we breathe, in the food we eat, and above all, it is in our spirits. Friends, life cannot die. The beautiful Jesus declared that we possess the power of life over death. And he said of the little girl, she's not dead but sleepeth. And he affirmed of the little daughter and said to her, Talitha Kumi, which is to be translated as, little lambkin, I say unto you, arise. And she was restored to life on this plane, but the truth is, life was there all the time. Jesus simply demanded that it show itself anew in her body. The master said that we too can exercise this commanding power over the life force if we choose. One of the hardest lessons I've had to learn as a practitioner of the science of mind is to be with someone who has chosen to relinquish their physical body on this plane, and being with them to sit by their side, knowing that they are not at the point of death, but rather at the point of life. Thank you, Jen. You know, so often we hang on to those we love and we don't want to let them go. We never learn how to say farewell. We hold on to them for our own selfish reasons, don't we? Even when we know that they need to make the journey that they have chosen. And instead of blessing them on their way, we say, no, don't leave me. There's a story a few years ago about a mother whose son was in a coma and who sat by his bedside literally for years, begging him not to go. And when she was finally convinced to release him, he opened his eyes for a moment and then quietly stepped out before they had to pull the plug of his life support equipment. We have to honor those people who have made the choice to move on. Thank God not many of us are faced with the challenge of having to make the kind of decision whether to take someone off life support or not. But we have all are called to live a richer life, a fuller life, and we can all draw upon the unlimited power of being with which we have been supplied by the law, the Lord, the law of the universe. And the wonderful thing is, life is always ready to respond to us. Life does not hold back. It does not try to elude us. It wants to express all its fullness and exuberance and is always seeking outlets through us. Take, for example, the tiny blade of nut grass forcing its way up through 1.5 inches of asphaltic concrete. It seems so fragile and delicate, this little leaf, this little sprig of grass, but just the same, it is strong enough to push through material that we require a pneumatic drill to penetrate. If you believe that you are the child of God and that God is life, then it follows that you too possess unlimited life, for your life is God's life, and God's life and yours must therefore be one. To consciously partake of it, we have to deliberately align ourselves with the well-being that constantly flows from the source of all life. Esther and Jerry Hicks, in a fascinating book titled Ask and It Is Given, which presents the teachings of the non-physical entity Abraham, describe this process of alignment as allowing. I love that phrase, that term. Allowing means to deliberately focus your attention upon things that cause you to offer a vibration to the universe that allows you to connect to your natural source. Can we learn to allow the energy that we have to align itself with the universal, inexhaustible, unstoppable, infinite energy with which we have been equipped to live and to experience and to enjoy the gift of life? Friends, it is absolutely necessary to know this so that you never say, boy, life is short, or boy, life is running out. I want you to know that all the life there is in you now, for God is your life, your source energy. Let us affirm together. All the life there is in me now. Together? All the life there is in me now. God is my life.
God is my source energy.
To your neighbor, say, all the life there is in you now. God is your source energy.
All the life there is in you now. God is your source energy. All the life there is in you now. God is your source energy.
Which brings me to your assignment. Your mission, should you decide to undertake it this week, is to affirm this over and over, to make it your mantra for this week. God is in me now. God is my source energy. Just keep that. Make a note in the back of your program. God is in me now. All the life there is in me now. God is my source energy. All the life there is in me now. God is my source energy. Say it when you feel anxious. Say it when you need to have renewed strength, and all your glands and organs, your nerves and muscles will respond, and you will get a second wind so that you can run the marathon of life with ease and grace, taking long, swift, strong strides, Refuse to believe that you are getting old and weak and that you must drag yourself around. My friend Margarita Rain just climbed Mount Kilimanjaro to celebrate her 60th birthday. How is that for? I can't wait to see the pictures and to hear the stories of that climb. Remember, they that trust in the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like the eagle. Fenwick Holmes, who was the brother of Ernest, wrote this poem titled Life is All. Life weaves the petal of the rose whose heart is opened as it grows, and from it scented sweetness flows. Yet we must breathe and be aware of perfume hovering in the air, or else for us it is not there. Awake my soul from thoughts of strife, from fears as cutting as a knife. Become again aware of life. Deny the claim of him who saith that life is swallowed up in death, and breathe God's life with every breath. Yes, friends, breathe God's life with every breath. Your life and God's life are one life. Jesus said, I am in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. It is because we are all part of the one life of God that a practitioner of this science can know the truth of life for you when you are experiencing too much pain to know it for yourself. In the words of our responsive reading today, we are not separated from life, neither is it separated from us. We are separate entities in it, individualized ventures of God consciousness, unquote. Please turn to page 7 of your program and read with me the words of wisdom entitled Life is One, Undivided, written by Dr. Carol Carnes. Are you there at page 7? Together. Life is not divided against itself. It is one something, one creative force, one intelligence, one creative energy, love, bringing itself into visibility, into matter, into form, extending itself as it were. Our world will be very different when we transcend the old perceptions and realize just how unified we actually are, not only with our source, which is constantly supplying us what we demand, but with one another. We are endowed with everything we need to live a life of beauty and love, prosperity and health. The first step is to rethink the God thing, into harmony with nature. You are not adrift in some cosmic sea of whimsy. You are the ocean and the boat and the wind and the destination. Make a demand of yourself and watch what happens. What is a demand? Simply put, it is your word. It is our personal and prevalent belief. It is our dominant perception. And so it is. And right under those words of wisdom on that same page of your program, Ernest Holmes and Alberta Smith assure us, and I quote, that life itself, fundamental, primordial, original life itself, which cannot conceive of death or non-existence, causes us to believe in immortality. That is why a time comes when we no longer think of immortality as though it were a thing to be gained, for immortality is now. If a man keep my saying, he shall never see death, unquote. We learn that we live and that immortality is just as much now as it will be after we think we are dead. That instinctive life in us which knows nothing about dying causes us all to believe in an endless existence. People believe in immortality unless they are educated otherwise, because it is instinctive, unquote. So let us affirm together, God is my life.
God is my life.
God is my perfect being.
God is my perfect being.
I am that I am.
I am that I am.
I am immortal.
I am immortal.
This is the truth, my friends. It is the truth. You are immortal. You are that I am. And all is well. Namaste.